Hi, my name is Dr. Brock Bernstein, and I was the project manager and the lead investigator on the Ocean Science Trust's recent evaluation of decommissioning options for oil and gas platforms offshore of Southern California. And our job was not to make recommendations about what to do with the platforms, but to look at a range of decommissioning options and evaluate the pros and cons of the different options, both from a technical perspective as well as from a legal and policy or regulatory perspective. And so what we did was evaluate all the available current information that we could get our hands on, and then organize that in terms of different sorts of impacts on, for example, socioeconomics, on different types of ocean uses, on air emissions and air quality, on water quality, on benthic habitats underneath the platforms, on fish and invertebrate communities on the platforms, and on costs, and then also on the legal liability and the regulatory implications for the state. And we looked at a range of options, including things such as using the platforms for ocean observing systems, using the platforms as wind energy or wave energy sites, using the platforms as aquaculture sites, and then taking the platforms out completely, and finally using the platforms as artificial reefs after taking the decks off and cutting the jacket legs off to 85 feet below the surface. And so what we found was that the only two options that were viable for the bulk of the platforms and were economically and legally viable and most feasible were the two that I mentioned last, that is taking the platforms out completely or cutting them off at 85 feet below the sea surface and turning them into artificial reefs. And the so what we did then was we looked at those two options in depth and evaluated the pros and cons of each. And what we found was that depending on the sorts of issues you cared about the most, you would tend to select one option or the other. In other words, there was no scientific evidence that conclusively demonstrated that one option was better than another. And so our job for the state was to organize that information and make it available and organized so that decision makers and the public would then have a better ability to discuss and consider the evidence for one approach or another in terms of what to do with these things. And for example, if you cared a lot about ecosystem integrity and cleaning up after ourselves in the ocean when we're done using the ocean, you might value taking the platforms out completely. On the other hand, if you were concerned about air emissions from all the heavy equipment used to take the platforms out, and you were concerned about maintaining the biological productivity on the rigs, you would probably prefer leaving the rigs in place as an artificial reef. And so we just provided information and a decision model that allowed managers and interested people in the public to then dig into that information in more detail and evaluate that information for themselves. In terms of the dollars, which a lot of people are interested in, taking the 27 platforms out completely would cost on the order of $1 billion to $1.25 billion. The partial removal option I described would save about $475 million. And typically what happens in that case is that cost savings is then split between the state and the operators. And there's nothing in the federal law that enables that mechanism. There's nothing in the federal law that specifies what that split should be, and then so that would have to be negotiated between the state and the operators.
I was charged with the task of dealing with the enormous amount of biological and physical information on the platforms on our coastline, with the model and integrating that into the model which Brock just briefly introduced to you. So there's this goal is to look at the information that's been collected, and there's a wealth of information, as many of you are aware, and then put it into an objective framework so that a user that doesn't really necessarily know much about biology or air emissions or whatever can make decisions. And so the work that I've done is really in that template of trying to synthesize biological information, which is obviously technical and quite complex, into a decision-based modeling effort. My research has been on nearshore ring fishing in the Southern California Bight, and I'm the guy that scuba dives in the kelp beds and has been studying these things for 25 years. But I had never worked on oil platform issues or decommissioning issues prior to this project. So one of the challenges with the issues with biological communities and platform decommissionings is that not all platforms are the same size, as you're probably well aware, and they are in different parts of the ocean, in different oceanographic regimes, and they represent very different biological communities. So for instance, if this works now, Platform Irene, which is, let me go back. Platform Irene, which is off of Point Conception, is going to be quite different than Platform Holly. It's on the shelf. Platform Holly is on the shelf, but something like Platform Gale is off the continental shelf, as you can see in this picture. And so these are very different habitats, very different oceanographic regimes. All right. So the first thing, of course, is the size. And this is a figure from the report, and I just kind of put in, it's been moved around a little bit, but put in the approximate depth of our local platforms. And so Platform Harmony would be one of the deeper ones in Eureka, and then Holly is shallower. And the two take-home messages from this, the take-home messages from the slide are the obvious comparisons to known features that we see on land. All right, so the Eiffel Tower, Empire State Building, and whatnot. The other thing, which I'll talk about again in the next slide, is if you look at the platform in this picture, they have very different structures. So they're not all platforms are the same. The difference is not just their depth. Some are more complex than others. They're different engineering structures, and that has different biological results and consequences.
Rethink how we go about extracting what we now take from mountaintops and from the depths of the sea, whether it's coal or oil or gas. The end product means not just situations of this sort, but we are changing the planet. If we allow the big message that comes from the spilling of oil, the gushing of oil from the heart of the Gulf of Mexico, 5,000 feet down, then we will have missed an opportunity for sure. Now, that's the bad news. I want to share with you now a little bit, just the taste of good news. Because a few weeks ago, in the company of some photographer friends and a scientist from the University of Southern Mississippi, Eric Hoffmeyer, we went out 70 miles south of Foshan, Louisiana, which is one of the ports that has been greatly afflicted. Along the coast, the marshes and beaches are just thick with great gobs of oil. And that's where many of these bronzed pelicans have come from. But in fact, we made our way across the ocean on an overnight trip. We didn't see much in the way of oil at the surface because we went a bit west and a little bit south of where the deep horizon spill was taking place. We were hoping to find whale sharks because Eric Hoffmeyer's specialty is whale sharks. He was interested in tagging them to find out where they might be going if we were successful in finding some that he had met just a year before at a place called Ewing Bank. And that's how we entertained ourselves on day one, diving around those great masses of floating seaweed. Day two started 5:30 in the morning with a crew member running around beating on doors saying, whale sharks, they're here. Were they ever? 100 whale sharks seemed to just magically converge from out of the blue, literally the blue. And for 11 hours, we swam with them. I want to share a little piece of the action with you now. Can we have that little clip, please? It's coming.
The reason we're here for this glimpse of what's happening in the Gulf is to try to find and tag some of the really big guys, the whale sharks.
These animals are in this region to feed, and in the area the oil spill is an important feeding area for them. It's essential habitat, and right now we don't know how they're responding to this oil.
It's an ocean full of whale sharks. I can't even count the number of fins. As soon as I think I have a number, six more pop up.
We need to start tagging these guys and looking at their movements in relation to the oil to determine if indeed they are avoiding it and staying away, or if they are actually going into it and succumbing to the oil.
What's up, man?
Get it, man.
How does that work? The Louisiana punch?
Double-duple.
I called him Samson because he was the biggest one. He was the Mac Daddy. He was the big boy of the bunch.
Two of those tags were spot tags. So they're surface satellite tags. So the first thing we want to do is get online, let's see how they're reported, how often they're reported, and all that. So hopefully we'll have hits from the day. As long as the satellite has to be overhead, and it comes overhead, you know, 3 to 6 times a day, as long as those two things line up, it will send a signal.
Ding, ding.
And they'll say, here I am.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see if they, what happens if they encounter the oil, where they go with it, you know?
The comment that some have said about the whale sharks in the Gulf of Mexico, that they're on death row, could be true. It could be that because of their feeding habits, they skim right at the surface where the oil accumulates. They're in harm's way.